Hey everybody, in this video I want to show you guys how to use little leather components in completed jewelry. So for this design I'm going to be using a pretty thin, like a 2 millimeter thick, I'm not sure what the ounce is on that, but relatively thin, not like the stiffer the better. This stuff's a little flimsy for what I would prefer, but it's what I have on hand and it still works out pretty well because you want your leather components to keep their shape, you know, roughly. It's not, you know, completely rigid, but it's also not like, you know, if you had cut it from a delicate fabric. And also this is, I don't know if I said that, but this is vegetable tanned cowhide. So it does have a really nice kind of, it takes tooling really well, it stains wonderfully, it's just a good all-purpose leather. Here I have a rubber stamp and just some regular, like, office ink for stamping things. I love it whenever the stamp has on the back the design directly in relation to where it's positioned, because that helps you kind of see where you're going to be pressing it. So let's go ahead and load our stamp up with some ink, just like that. And then I want to find a spot that doesn't have any imperfections or blemishes. Over here actually looks pretty great. Now see where this fold kind of naturally happens in the leather? I don't want to do it centered up on that because that will translate into the completed piece. So I'm going to try to be off to the side of that just a little bit. And let's get a nice clean imprint. Just boop, and then press. Just like that. And so I'm going to set that off to the side. And I'm going to come through with, these are heavy duty leather shears, but you can totally get away with just using regular scissors. But I like the shears because they do a real good clean job of, I'm going to go ahead and just cut off this extra piece. That scrap pieces like this are perfect for using for if you want to test out, some dyes. Like if you want to see how two combinations of, EcoFlow look when they're blended together, this is a great way to sample it, but keep in mind, not all leather behaves the same. So this might stain a different color than, say, this piece of leather here. Even though they were both from the same side, they were from different parts, and then it can get even more variable the more different sides that you use. So that's just something to keep in mind. Okay, so I'm going to come in and just cut along the lines, being real careful to not, like, you know, cut through our design here. And trimming around the bend there. And I'm using a black ink here because I'm going to be doing a pretty dark brown stain. It's actually going to be an antique gel, so the black will lend itself to being darker kind of at the sides. I wouldn't recommend using the black if you're just leaving the leather plain, because you can leave vegetable tanned leather just unstained if you like this nice, very light, you know, tannish brown color. Just snipping kind of carefully. Take as much time as you feel like you need. If you snip off the points sharp like that, you can just take it and kind of round it around. There we go. Just like that. So I'm going to set this leather off to the side because you can see I can get a whole bunch of these out of this one piece that's left over, even working around all the imperfections on it. And so now what we're going to be doing is I have a small cutting board and I have, this is a filigree point. It's a tool for leather working where it cuts out that shape. Like it's a filigree punch, I guess not point. and the way that I like to use this, excuse me, is to come in and line it up right where the points of the design happen, where it's going to be, you want to be able to get nice and tight into that corner. And then I have a rawhide head mallet here. Just kind of pounding that out. And I'm just going to go through around on all of these internal locations and kind of punch the corners out. And you just want to be nice and careful with your placement. There's no reason at all to rush this. So you can see it kind of comes out like that. And if you get to a point like on this piece here that I'm punching out, it can be really difficult. Like, if I were going to try to get that point right there, it would exceed into the rest of the design. So I'm going to try to avoid doing that, and we'll come back through later, the next round through, with this straight edge wood chisel, and I'll show you how I use that to get the nice clean lines. And until then, you just kind of slow and steady wins the race. Some of these things are nothing if not repetitive, so just keep at it. Maybe have some music on that you really enjoy. And I mean, there are so many different things that you can do with a tool like this, that, like I can show you here on this center part, you can take it and actually make little punched out hearts if you're doing like a mask or something, or a bracelet, or I mean just anything like that. The possibilities really are endless. And especially when used in conjunction with other tools, you can really get some cool results. Now this one, I'm actually going through and using this same tool to straighten out the sides, because they're nice and round. Like, just chiseling it out like that. Got a couple more to do. So a lot of people, when they think of leatherworking, they think of like big bulky armor pieces, or you know, Renaissance fair gear or LARPing gear, or you know, costume pieces. But so much of leather can be done in a very small and delicate way for jewelry as well. There we go. And now I'm actually going to come through with, this is a 1/16 inch hole punch. It's the smallest punch I've been able to find. And I'm just going to come in where each of these little open parts on the tips of this Celtic knot, I'm just going to punch a little hole. So there we go. And now we have our straight edge wood chisel. This was a walnut hollow. I think it's kind of worn off a little bit over the years. But brand wood carving tool that I got at probably Hobby Lobby or Michael's or somewhere. and then so you'll just want to come in and line up and then push down. See how that it chops right through. So line it up, press it down. And I find, especially on a thinner leather like this, you don't even need to use the hammer. It's such a sharp tool. And we're just going to go through and kind of keep carving out the inside of the negative space for these knots. And a goal here is to try to keep the lines and the corners as clean and smooth as possible. But don't worry if there's a little bit of like weirdness going on, because after we stain this, I'll show you guys how to like make it look real sharp and clean. I'm just kind of getting there and carefully. Again, a focus is to have nice clean lines. So just kind of whittle it out. And so like on this one, how I'd shown you for those corners, I'll just come in and cut. And come in and cut. And just like that, it's nice and open now. If this were a thicker leather, I don't know, like, I would probably incorporate using the hammer a lot more just to get the chisel through the leather. There we go. It's coming along nicely. We're on our last little cutout part. And if you don't have a little shaped chisel or a punch like how I was using, you could try to go ahead and just do this with just a wood carving tool, but I really like the having one of these little teardrop punches. I used to, before I had this one, I did it all with just the chisel. Okay. So now we have that. I'll just set that there for now. And all of our scrap leather here can actually go just into a houseplant. Makes excellent mulch. I don't know, you know, if you're real worried about chemicals and stuff, I wouldn't use it as a mulch on anything that you're going to eat. But for just ornamentals and stuff, I haven't had any problems with it. Okay, so now let me grab, if I can. Here we have a piece of freezer paper that has a waxy, shiny side and a dry paper side. I want to have this shiny side up because it repels the stain. And here we have a tan EcoFlow, EcoFlow Gel Antique from Tandy Leather. I think it's like, if you have an elite membership with them, it's like $8 for a bottle, and a bottle goes a long way. So I'm also going to pull some gloves out, because if it'll stain leather, it'll stain your skin more likely than not. And then I'm also going to want some paper towels. Hey Randy, could you grab me some paper towels? Like, I have some Charmin Ultra Strong toilet paper here, but it just doesn't hold up the same. I'd prefer paper towels, actually. Yeah, he just handed, like, he was gonna hand me a thing of, like, Wendy's or Long John Silver's, like, napkins, and sometimes a good, strong, absorbent paper towel is just the way to go. Thank you, honey. So I'm going to pull off a couple of squares of that. And then I'm also going to have a squirt bottle here of water. Okay, so we're going to want to shake up the bottle because that distributes the pigments evenly throughout the medium. And I'm just going to get a pretty generous amount. Like, with the antique gel, you always want to use just a little bit more than what you would think you would need to. Just gooping it up. And usually when I'm making these, I make them in, like, in a batches of, like, 10. And then I just stain them all at once. That way, any extra stain that's on the table, I'll just go ahead and put on another piece. So I had one that was finished over here on the side. And we're just going to come through and stain them. And I do go ahead and do the front and back because I'll show you all how I'm going to seal this to keep it from staining your skin or clothing funny colors if you sweat or if it gets wet while you're wearing it. I mean, really, that's less than you want to have to worry about. Okay, so there's that. I'm going to wipe the excess off of my gloves. And usually, especially if I'm only wearing gloves for a little bit like this, these gloves are totally reusable. So I usually just try to stick with using them for that one color. And so now I'm going to fold up this paper towel and spritz some water on it. I'm going to pull these off to the side. And I'm just going to kind of wipe. And so you can really see here. The difference between one that has been wiped and one that has not. Wiped, not wiped. And wiping all of this extra pigment off really does, I mean, it makes such a difference, you guys. Let's see what I mean, how it'll stain your hands. I took my gloves off a little too soon, but oh well. Now, also, on these, I've gone through and stained them. Like, you could just leave it like this, and it's a perfectly fine. It's got a little bit of the black lines showing, you know, where the knots would overlap. But this looks more like a laser woodcut piece, and less like something that's wonderfully and uniquely handmade. So what we're going to do is I'm going to grab out a swivel knife. And I'm actually going to take this, and I'm going to do a very light cut across these lines on the leather. This is the one that I've been doing. Yeah, just kind of come in and slice in. You don't, especially on a thin leather like this, you really don't want to cut all the way through. It's just enough to break the surface. Just kind of coming through like that. And normally I would do this before staining, but I really like to give y'all options. And so just coming through like that, doing these cuts. And again, you could totally leave it at this step. And I would recommend going back through and staining it to make sure that you get a nice... Oh gosh, I'm so sorry. I meant to be on camera for that. Because you don't see how that's lighter because it's showing leather that hasn't been stained. You'd probably want to go back through and stain that up. Since I did that one off camera, I'll do this one on camera. How about that? Am I on camera? Yes. Okay. And I'm just coming through and kind of cutting the lines. And if you ever, like this one, the stamp lines faded out. So if this line went over, then this one, then it's going to go under this one. So these lines will come across that way. And that's usually something to keep in mind with most Celtic knotwork, is there's always going to be, or in most cases, there's going to be an over-under pattern. Like, different styles of knotwork have different repetitions and stuff, but for the most part. So there we go. You just go through and just cut the little lines like that. This is the edge of the swivel knife that I'm using. You could also just use like a craft knife and stuff, but I really like how these ones, you apply the pressure from up top right there, and then you turn it with your fingers. So that can be, it can be difficult to get the hang of initially, but for me, it really paid off to just learn how to use one and get used to it. And now we'll be going through with, this is a beveler foot. You can see how it's wider on one end and narrow on the other, and it has this nice texture on there. So I'm going to come through with this and just hammer it and kind of walk it along. And so you can see the way that that burnished the leather, and you just do it right along the cut, and it's going to imprint it down to where it looks like that leather's traveling underneath this leather, even though it's all one piece. So, and this one needed re-dyed anyhow, so. But I'm gonna see if maybe it works better if I zoom out a bit for you. But I'm just gonna go through and so see how that's starting to really give us a nice, because it burnishes as well as imprinting. And that's just, I just love that effect that it has. Okay, where do I leave off? Because this is something that kind of, whenever I lose my place, it's like, oh boy. And even though it's quite narrow here, I'm still trying to do multiple taps, like kind of coming in from one side and then, you know, walking it across and just giving it as much depth and detail as what I can. I've said it before and I'll say it again, the magic happens in the details. And so this adds, I mean, a lot more work, but also so much more detail. Like, so much more. I don't even know what that noise is. And don't hesitate to rotate or reposition your project as you feel necessary. This is an art, not a science. There's no wrong way to get to where you're going. Ah! Okay, so there, I started doing it on the wrong side. That's okay. Everything's gonna be okay. Disaster averted. Okay. So now we can double check and make sure that we got all of our lines. It does look like it. And so now you can see the difference between tooled and untooled. now what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to go through and I'm going to stain this again. And on stuff like this one, where it's already been mostly stained, I'm actually just going to take the cap and I'm going to dab my finger in there, get some pigment on my finger, and I'm going to come through and kind of position and place the stain where I feel like I need it. And with antique gels, you really want to focus on getting it gooped up in all those little nooks and crannies and recesses where you did your tooling. I'm going to come through and make sure, double, triple certain, that I've treated my edges the way that I would like. Okay, so there's that. Now we've got our little pad of paper towel, and I'm going to wipe the excess off. And whenever I'm wiping off the excess, I'm not like grinding down and in between where my tooling and stuff was, because I don't want that ground out. Like, I want it to kind of dry and settle in there. Okay, gloves off. Clean up my mess for just a minute. And so now, again, you can really, really see now the difference in depth between tooled and textured and not tooled. Like, if I were shopping, I would get this one over this one, hands down. I mean, like, that's just beautiful. Oh, I'm so pleased with that. Okay, so now we come to a situation where our inside edges are still not as crispy clean as I would have liked them to be. So you can kind of see, it makes it look very organic, and you can leave it like that if you like. But let's see what we would do if we didn't want it like that. So, here I have a chopstick. Normally I would use something like this here, which is my edge slicker, but you can see it's much thicker, and on this one I can't fit my edge slicker into all of these detailed areas, and so I have this product here called Aussie Wax, which is like so deliciously awesome. Like, don't eat it, but the smell of it though, the feel of it, like it keeps my hands really soft even through all the yard work and everything that I do. So when people are like, oh, what's your favorite hand balm? I'm like, Aussie Wax. So, and then I have a piece of really oily denim, and I'm going to take this and I'm actually just going to dab it and rub it on, and you can see it's really gunking up in between everything, and oh, it's gross and sticky, and well, not sticky, but like goopy, and it's just, it's getting everywhere, and that's exactly what you want it to do, because this is conditioning the leather, it's sealing the pores, and it's going to help it repel moisture. That way, as you're wearing it, especially on an area where if you sweat a lot, you really don't want that to get into your leather and it get like mildewy, and it's that moisture that's going to cause your leather to start to deteriorate. So now I've rubbed it in with my finger pretty well. I'm going to come through and kind of buff it with said oily blue jean. And just again, this is going to help remove even more of that surface pigment. And I'm going to take this chopstick and I'm going to come, and this is a square at one side, round at the other chopstick. And so you can take this and actually just really get in there. Do, do, do. So it's almost almost akin to like sanding. It's like I were coming through and sanding all of my stuff. So there I did the center part. And it just kind of compacts and shapes the leather down a little bit. And it, again, it's just another one of those little details that, yeah, you don't have to do it, but man, whenever you do. And it also, you can see it's getting some like stain and stuff. It cleans it up. Excuse me. Excuse me, jeez. Excuse me, sorry, it's allergy season, so I'm slowly dying to death. So there we are, you guys. A very beautiful, I mean, lot of detail. Do you have any water, Randy? That I could have some? Thank you so much. So it's a lot of work and a lot of detail, but I feel so much like it's worth it. You know, in making your products look just a step above and beyond. That and the feel of it too. Like this one feels kind of like dry and crunchy. This one just feels silky. So nice. Okay, so now how do we turn this into a completed piece of jewelry? I'll show you. First and foremost, I'm going to take, we have this green teardrop bead. It's pressed glass, so the color is solid all the way through, so you don't have to worry about the color rubbing off and deteriorating over time. Then this is a head pin. It's 22 gauge, and you can see it's like a small nail. It has a little nail head on there. And so we'll just slide that right through our bead. And then I am going to take some pliers. And do a 90 degree bend, just like that. And now I have my round nose pliers. And I'm going to place the bead in there. And I'm going to wrap around. And this is called a wrapped loop. Just wrapping all the way around until it crosses, just like that. And now I'm going to place that back on my round nose pliers, and I'm going to position it like this. So I realize this isn't the best background. How about that? There we go. And now I'm going to take these bent nose pliers. I'm going to you can use whatever pliers you like, but I really love my bent nose. I'm going to grip it and then just start wrapping it around. I don't know, I always refer to the loops as the heads and then this part as the neck, like if the bead were the rest of the body. And so I'm just wrapping it very snugly and closely around the neck. Excuse me. And so now you can see I still have a little excess. Oh, come on, camera, don't go in and out of focus. A little excess peeking off the side there. So I'm going to take my wire snips that I've been saying for months that I need a new pair of, but they seem to be getting me by. And so I've snipped it off as close as I can, and then I'm actually going to come in with these bent nose, and again, stabilizing with my round nose pliers, and just smoosh, smoosh, smoosh. Getting that all nice and snug down, because the last thing you want is for it to tangle on, like if you have a knitted sweater or if you just have very delicate skin. And so there's that. Where did our letter piece go? There it is. Okay. And one of these is slightly longer than the other two. So that's going to be the one that I have coming down. And here I have an 18 gauge 1/4 inch ring. And I'm going to open it. And I'm going to thread it through right here. And I use a lot of different metal tones in my work, because this way, even though the teardrop was wrapped in brass, and I've just threaded it through the hole and threaded that teardrop on, I want whoever, you know, is going to be wearing this to be able to wear it with silver or gold-toned jewelry. And now you can see it's having just a little bit of mobility problems right there. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to come through, and I'm actually going to round this point down significantly. Like, significantly. Because it's more important to me that it... Gravity! Sorry, it's more important to me that the necklace wears well than that somebody looks at it and be like, well, that's not perfectly pointed. It's like, trust me, you'll notice a lot more if it doesn't lay properly than you will if it's not perfectly pointed. So now I go back again and stain the tip, because I don't want to leave just a little unfinished edge like that. And so, I mean, it's never, ever too late to go back and touch something up and fix it. There we go. Just touching up the edge like that. Just wiping it off. Makes such a difference. It's those details, guys. And even though, like, on our website, I sell these for $15. Because, I mean, it goes by... Oh, 15 or 20, I can't remember. But it goes by so quickly whenever I'm doing, like, batches and batches of them and not really, like, talking the whole time. but I want you all to know exactly what's going through my head whenever I'm making them, all the different ways that you can do it. It's like, I don't know. If whenever I watch a tutorial, I prefer something very thorough as opposed to something that is off camera all the time, Yvonne. Sorry. Okay, so now I'm going to come through on the other sides and add in a ring like this. But no, it's really, I'd rather watch a tutorial that has way more information than what I need than a tutorial that, you know, has gaps in it. Because it's like, well, how did you do, why did you do that? Okay, so there we are. Those little rings added in. And then this is a chain that I really like to use. It's by Bead Landing. I get it from Michaels. It's 12 yards for like 10 bucks, which I feel like is a pretty decent deal for it. And it's aluminum, so very non-reactive. It doesn't turn my skin green. I love it. And I'm going to measure out... Let's see. Got a little ruler here. Switch it into inch mode. Most of my necklaces I make to have a minimum of 16 inches. Because, like, unless somebody wants it, like, as a very snug choker, usually 16 inches will sit, like, around here on most adult women. Like, some teenagers have, like, a 14-inch neck, but we sell a lot to, like, women. And I can always do in-booth modifications. But so I'm going to cut this off at about 7.5. And if you'll focus on the big screen right now, or like the zoomed out screen, I just come up and I find the point where I'm going to be snipping it, and then I travel down the length of the chain and get it to line up, and then I go snip up here, and then I snip down here, and that way I don't have to mess around with measuring twice. So there's those. Gonna put that away. And then here I have some enameled copper chain from theringlord.com. I really enjoy their products. And I'm just going to find a loose end, and I'm going to open up about a hand's width, which is like almost 4 inches. But this is what I use for the extender chain. And this is a 20 gauge chain, so if you wanted to make your own rings. And on one end of one of these chains, I am going to hook the extender chain through. Now again, I always do in-booth modifications, but for the most part, I make our chains to where they will hook most easily for someone who is right-handed. But I always kind of ask folks, I'm like, hey, are you right or left-handed? Because it's so easy for me to just swap it there in the booth to make it however, you know, is easier for them. Okay, so now we have these two chains off on either side. And I have a little, like, 13 by 7 millimeter lobster clasp. And these are 18 gauge, 1/8 inch bright aluminum rings that we sell on our website. And I'm just going to open that up, and I'm going to thread the clasp on it. And I'm going to thread that through the chain. And you could totally go through and make your own chain out of wrapped beads or, you know, anything like that. But this is how, whenever I'm making a necklace that has a very involved focal point, but I want to keep the price point as low as possible, this is where, you know, I use a quality chain. You know, it's not welded, but it holds together really well. And the ring lord does carry some welded iron, like enameled iron, that holds up exceptionally well. But by finishing it off with just chain, it makes it very layerable and easy to accessorize, and it also, like, keeps the price down. And whenever, you know, you're making for inventory and stuff, if you want to go do an event, sometimes, you know, a person will come through and they'll love a necklace, but they'll only have a $20 bill, you know, and sometimes they'll love it so much that they'll splurge and spend $40. But it's, you know, trust your own judgment and gauge for yourself what you want your price points to be. But this is how I keep my time investment down on some pieces. Okay, so there we go. And that is how I do a completed necklace. Let's see how it looks on. And the nice thing about this extender chain is you can hook it anywhere along the length of that chain. And it just sits like that. So I'm really pleased with how that came out, you guys. It's a very nice, lightweight, cool necklace, nice little knotwork. So yeah, I hope that this tutorial was helpful to you guys. I hope if you have any questions, comments, or ideas that you'll contact me. That way I can help you out in any way that I can. What else? Oh, I do periodic giveaways. Like, we do a bi-monthly fairy house giveaway that's exclusive to our patrons, as well as sometimes we're doing them on Facebook or Instagram or here on YouTube, just all over the place. But if you're interested in participating, you know, be sure to subscribe and maybe follow us on Facebook and Instagram. If you just Google Back to Earth Creations, we're like, it'll get you there. It's all of our social media is some rendition of Back to Earth Creations. Like, some of them have spaces, some of them have underscores. I don't remember. but if you're interested in supporting the creation of more free tutorials like this one, as well as participating in our patron exclusive giveaways, please check us out on Patreon. There should be a link down in the video description below where if you go and pledge just $1 a month, it puts your name in the hat to win, you know, the fairy house. But we do the giveaways twice a month, so it's like putting your name in the hat twice. Whereas if you pledge $5, it puts you in for each drawing 5 times. And also, if you're a patron, it gives you VIP access to all of our other giveaways without having to do any additional liking or sharing or commenting or anything like that. So it's pretty cool. And also, it helps support free tutorials. And if you're interested in getting your hands dirty with some crafting on Patreon, if you pledge $10 or more a month, you have an option to get a free gift every month for the value of what you pledge,
Or you can get a kit and material, like kits and materials, every month for the value of what you've pledged. And those are usually geared around either what you're interested in as a crafter or the tutorials that we have coming out either in the month prior or in the month coming. So that's pretty exciting. And so yeah, thanks you guys again. I hope you enjoyed. I really enjoyed getting to share this with you. So have a wonderful day and happy crafting. Bye.